Well, thank you all for being here. There was a snow squall that suddenly appeared on the walk over from SAC, and I had to turn right back and grab my jacket. So thank you for braving the elements to be with us this afternoon. And thank you especially to Barbara Wall and this wonderful opportunity. It's a great support, particularly to baby professors like myself, to have this opportunity to get in front of the university and to speak, and I'm grateful. And I'm also very grateful for the funding that Veritas provided. Much of this research was possible because of that grant. I was able to present a version of this presentation at Boston College this past summer at a conference there. A longer version, I'm sparing you the unabridged version, is currently under review by Horizons. So I'm very, very grateful for the support that the Veritas was able to provide. Another mark I want to make is within the field of theology, there's different specialties, different disciplines, like any other academic discipline. And I'm mindful of this because Father Fitzgerald came up and greeted me as soon as I walked in, as well did Professor Camacho greeted me as I walked in. And I'm going to talk about Augustine, but that's a little out of my wheelhouse. And I'm intimidated by their presence because they have an expertise that I can't claim to approximate. So I'm grateful for the opportunity to speak about Augustine. As Barbara mentioned, my background is in theological education and theological pedagogy, so I'll focus upon that during my remarks. But I welcome those that have a deeper, a more vast background in Augustine than me to correct me along the way as needed. And then lastly, I want to say that Barbara also mentioned that I'm new here to Villanova. Madison, come on in, have a seat. And this is after spending over 15 years in education with the Jesuits. So I'm learning slowly about the difference that charism makes in animating a Catholic university. So I was particularly grateful to have the opportunity to explore friendship in Augustine. And lastly, I want to thank all the students that are here who may have came because they were bribed, or they may have came because they love learning for its own sake. But regardless, you're here. And any teacher will tell you that the greatest insights that we have, particularly as pedagogues, is a result of being in the classroom with you. So I thank you for your role in bringing these ideas to fruition. So with those opening remarks, I'll begin. There has been a ferment of reflection on Catholic higher education in the 25 years since the promulgation of Ex Corde Ecclesiae from the heart of the church. There are multiple catalysts for this lively conversation. For some, there is the concern that a basically secular ethos has displaced the intentionally religious orientation of Catholic education, such that Christian faith and the church's teaching authority matter little, if at all. In other words, there is worry that U.S. Catholic universities have followed or are following the pattern set by their elite Protestant counterparts. There are others, now forming a critical mass of teachers and scholars in Catholic higher educations, who don't have a feel for a theologically grounded vision of education. Most of the dominant academics in Catholic colleges and universities today have themselves been educated in a desacralized culture and society in which the academic vocation entails, as Max Weber puts it, quote, specialists without spirit, senseless without heart, end quote. Through no fault of their own, perhaps, academics in the main would find Michael Buckley's axiom bewildering. Quote, the fundamental proposition that grounds the Catholic university is that the academic and the religious are intrinsically related, that they form an inherent unity, that one is incomplete without the other, end quote. The Catholic university's quest for self-understanding in the 21st century unfolds within the context of these markedly distinct horizons. This essay enters into an already vibrant discussion about the mission identity of Catholic higher education today. While philosophical and theological frameworks abound, such appeals on their own are unlikely to speak meaningfully to those who don't already embrace the relationship of faith and reason similar to that articulated in Fides et Ratio. The Bernard Lonergan-inspired approach of John Hoy's Where is Knowing Going is noteworthy in its attention to the foundational role of cognitional theory, or what R.J. Schnell and Stephen Cohn have called noetic exegesis in their account of the Christian University and authentic cosmopolitanism. Yet strikingly absent in this burgeoning field of scholarship is attention to pedagogy as a set of concrete teaching practices animating university life. In fact, this fundamental yet often neglected aspect of higher education may be fertile ground for more effectively communicating the vision of a Catholic university today. A pedagogy of friendship illuminates the quality of the conversation that a Catholic university is. What I do, as a matter of fact, when I read, understand, interpret, translate, etc., is intimately bound up with who I am. Genuine communication is substantive or constitutive and is epitomized by friendship. Friendship is both a sign of conversion, and it sets the conditions for the possibility for ongoing conversion that originates in God and evokes our cooperation. The question of what makes a Catholic university Catholic is pedagogical because it is a question touching the most radical and mysterious intersection of human speaking and listening with divine transcendence. This essay proceeds in three parts. I will first briefly explore Augustine's understanding of friendship in the Confessions. Maureen Tilley states that Augustine examines the theme of friendship more than any other religious figure. That Augustine relates friendship to grace is an innovation which Thomas Aquinas later develops in a more systematic manner. Second, I will introduce Tom Groom's renowned shared Christian praxis approach as a pedagogy of friendship. A shared praxis approach may animate university life in authentic friendship. And third, I will outline the potential contribution of a pedagogy of friendship within the hyper-specialized, technocratic, and commodified culture of Catholic higher education today. A pedagogy of friendship is therefore a promising heuristic for a Catholic university's self-understanding in our time. Okay, so there's a lot going on there. Basically, three parts. The first part is Augustine on friendship, specifically in the Confessions. The second part is Thomas Groom's shared Christian praxis, which is a pedagogy emerging out of religious education, and I'm proposing that as a pedagogy of friendship animating the Catholic University. And then lastly, what is that pedagogy of friendship's potential contribution for a Catholic university in our time? Okay, so part one, Augustine on friendship. Friendship is a leitmotif in Augustine's Confessions. Friends factor preeminently as Augustine tells his story, and he thinks deeply about his friendships. In his youth, he desires simply, quote, to love and to be loved, unquote. Who doesn't want that, right? To love and to be loved. But he does not yet recognize friendship's ambiguity. Thus, he seeks friendship in the theft of a pear tree and in the conquest of women. Such friendships are false because they are built upon pride rather than a fruitful and virtuous ordering of things to the proper end. Because truth is avoided, no true intellectual communion can take hold in such false friendships. Quote, no restraint was imposed by the exchange of mind with mind, which marks the brightly lit pathway of friendship, end quote. Augustine captures the ordinary aspects of friendship in its everyday nature. Augustine says, to make conversation, to share a joke, to perform mutual acts of kindness, to read together well-known books, to share in trifling and in serious matters, to disagree though without animosity. Just as a person debates with himself, and in the very rarity of disagreement to find the salt of normal harmony, to teach each other something or to learn from one another, to long with impatience for those absent, to welcome them with gladness on their arrival, end quote. Above all, Augustine praises love for its wondrous ability to create unity out of many. He remarks, quote, human friendship is also a nest of love and gentleness because of the unity it brings about between many souls, end quote. The everyday nature of love teaches us that its foundation is the love of God. One of Augustine's most famous and instructive references to friendship is in his discussion of the death of a friend in Book 4. Augustine movingly describes the intense friendship he had forged with an unnamed companion in Thagaste, a friend since childhood. He remarks, quote, I had poured out my soul onto the sand by loving a person sure to die as if he were never died, end quote. Augustine considers the piercing grief at the death of his friend. Quote, rest in him and you will be at rest. Where are you going to a long, rough pass? What is the goal of your journey? The good which you love is from him, but is only as it is related to him that it is good and sweet. Otherwise, it will justly become bitter. For all that comes from him is unjustly loved if he has been abandoned. End quote. In light of his intellectual, moral, and religious conversion, Augustine understands anew the nature of his attachment to his friend and the relation of this love to the love of God. Gilbert Meleander explains, quote, Augustine concludes not that he has been mistaken to attach himself to his friend, but that he had a mistaken assign and a call for a resting place, end quote. An inordinate love halts prematurely the dynamic movement of love to the goal toward which it leads. For Augustine, true friendship transforms its attachment in relation to the love of God. The Confessions mark Augustine's recognition that it was primarily God's grace, not his own choices and decisions, that brought him over to the saving act of his baptism. Joseph Leinhardt observes that from the writing of Confessions onwards, Augustine underscores grace, or the Holy Spirit, as the cause of the sympathy in true friendship. True friendship is a union that has its cause beyond itself. Augustine writes, quote, friendship is not true unless you establish it as a bond between those who cleave to you through the charity poured out in our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us, end quote. Of course, that's a reference to Romans 5:5. In her study of friendship in Augustine, Mary Aquinas McNamara calls this definition of Augustine's, quote, most original contribution to the idea of friendship, end quote. The particular friendships, philia, are sublated into caritas, God's universal love. Meleander remarks, quote, philia is transcended in caritas, but not destroyed, for the intensely personal sharing which friendship involves is added to charity as its internal fruition, end quote. The friend is not left behind in love's divine ascent. Augustine's understanding of friendship is transformed within the vision of human life as pilgrimage. The special bonds of friendship lead us to the universal love of caritas. In learning to care for our friends, we may learn what it means to care for any human being, a love which is implicitly universal. Adele Fiske explains, quote, the friend is not lost in the absolute, not left behind as a step in the ascent, but in a permanent revelation of God, a necessary complement to the soul in its movement to God, end quote. Book 8 of the Confessions illuminates the role of friends in conversion, as well as the divine initiative of the Holy Spirit. Pontificationes' two friends are converted to the monastic life through the chance reading of the life of Anthony while together. Augustine writes, quote, he read on and was changed within himself, where your eyes could see, end quote. Alypius, one of the few persons mentioned by name in the first part of the Confessions, is present with Augustine in the garden. When Augustine first speaks of Alypius in the Confessions, he remarks, quote, "He was greatly attached to me because he thought I was a good and learned man, and I was fond of him, because although he was still quite young, it was quite clear he had a natural disposition of goodness," end quote. Alypius and Augustine studied rhetoric together and spent time with the Manichaeans before being baptized by Ambrose on the same night. They both later became bishops. Michael Foley observes that Augustine mentions many friends prior to Book 8, but he almost never calls them by name. After his conversion, Augustine chronicles many more friendships and includes their names. A satisfactory explanation is that friendships in the latter part of the Confessions are true. They include a third partner, God. Alypius and Augustine exemplify this relationship. Peter Brown has well described Augustine as, quote, "delightfully and tragically exposed," end quote, to the one thing he found unfathomable, friendship. Okay, so that's the first part, Augustine on friendship. So now we move on to the pedagogy piece. In light of the foregoing study of Augustine, Thomas Groom's shared Christian praxis approach may be understood as a pedagogy of friendship. Groom first introduced his what he calls life to faith to life approach in his work Christian Religious Education in 1980 and Sharing Faith, a Comprehensive Approach to Religious Education and Pastoral Ministry in 1991 provides its most robust account. Groom has summarized it as, quote, "a participative and dialogical pedagogy in which people reflect critically on their own historical agency and time and place and on their sociocultural reality, have access together to the Christian story vision, and personally appropriate it in community with the creative intent of renewed praxis in Christian faith toward God's reign for all creation." Well, that's pretty simple and straightforward, right? Well, we're going to unpack that. The focusing activity in five movements set the conditions for the possibility of friendship, uniting the participants with one another in reference to the friendship with God. The focusing activity aims to engage people's interest and prepare them for active participation in the teaching learning event. It intends to center a shared conversation on a generative theme. The generative theme, a term borrowed by Paulo Freire, is a concern of present praxis that invites participants to active engagement because of its meaningful import in their lives. The generative theme is established in the focusing activity, typically organizes the teaching-learning event throughout and is echoed in the subsequent five movements. The focusing activity is grounded in a theological conviction that God continues to reveal God's self in history through ordinary daily life events. And we can actively encounter and recognize God's self-communication by reflecting upon present action in the world. So, we begin with a focusing activity around a generative theme that centers, that guides the conversation, and is echoed throughout the five movements. So movement one, the educator encourages participants to express themselves around the generative theme as they encountered it in their personal lives. The expression of present practice may be mediated verbally, textually, dramatically, aesthetically, or by other modes of communication. The dynamic of this first movement is a question or questioning activity that invites participants to name or express generative themes as present in their lives. Smaller conversations may help to clarify a participant's response to M1 questioning before entering into the larger conversation. The intent of movement two is to invite participants to reflect critically on the praxis as they described it in M1. And share this critical reflection and conversation as a community. Depending upon the theme, Critical reflection can engage reason, memory, imagination, or a combination of them. Such reflection is both personal and sociocultural. The invitation is not only to express a theme of present praxis, but also to have participants critically examine their own interpretations of it. The dynamic of this movement, of movement two, is to evoke critical and creative reflection so that the participants can discern and understand what's going on in their lives as it regards the generative theme. The objective of this movement is that participants articulate their story and vision as an entryway into the Christian story and vision. The pedagogical task of movement three is to offer a discerning hermeneutics of the Christian story and vision as it intersects the lives of the participants. Groom comments, quote, "I reiterate that the story and vision are to be made present in a persuasive way and as meaningful to participants. The face should connect with their souls, make sense to their minds, ring true to their experience, and be an enticing way to make meaning out of life," end quote. The educator discerns both what to make accessible and how to communicate it. The Christian story is often enriched through dialogue and collaboration with other religious traditions by recognizing the truth and grace found in non-Christian mediations of meaning as well. Following Gadamer's critique of the prejudice against prejudice, this movement invites educators to be aware of the pre-understandings they inevitably bring to the interpretive act and be mindful that all human knowledge is finite and historically situated. Move on to movement four. Movement four intends for people to make judgments for themselves regarding the truth, wisdom, and services of Christian faith as it implicates their lives. The dynamic of this movement invites participants to place their own story and vision in dialectic encounter with the Christian story and vision. Here, the pedagogical key is to encourage participants to discern how these two sources, Christian faith and their lives, mutually mediate one another. M4 questions seek to articulate how understandings have shifted or broadened because of the dialectic encounter. Educators may raise questions that prompt participants' thoughts, feelings, and sense of how they can respond to the wisdom made accessible to them. Participants are invited in Movement 5 to choose and decide how they might live in response to their dialectical encounter with the Christian story and vision. The decisions may be cognitive, affective, or behavioral. Likewise, they may be made individually or communally. As with previous movements, M5 takes the form of an invitation that respects the freedom and personal journey in faith of all participants. This is a takeaway movement that capitalizes the momentum of the previous movement's encounters and judgment with a summons to action at the level of the participants' developmental and existential readiness. For example, what have you learned today and how might it influence your life? It is a standard question for reflection conversation of Movement 5. Shared conversation often inspires others towards decision making. The practical intent of decision is not merely what to do, but who to become. The expansion of a common consciousness and conscience is a function of the shared dimension of Groom's pedagogy of friendship throughout all five movements. Groom says, quote, "The word shared points to this approach as one of mutual partnership, active participation and dialogue with oneself, with others, with God, and with the story and vision of Christian faith," end quote. Gadamer observes how friends function as a privileged source of self-understanding. Quote, "Through exchange with our friends who share our views and intentions, but also who correct or strengthen them, we draw near to the divine, which possesses continually what is possible for us humans only intermittently, presence, wakefulness, self-presence, and Geist," end quote. Friendship enables education to liberate us from the limited viewpoint of the present. Friendship and education are inextricably linked in the reality of a liberal education to which John Henry Newman dedicated his life. in which it was enshrined in the Jesuit Ratio Studiorum, the ideal of friendship with authors of the great books, and friendship based upon a common reading of those books. Shared Christian praxis, pedagogy of friendship sets the conditions for the possibility of such friendships to emerge and flourish. Okay, so what the heck does this look like? So this is an outline, a scheme. Hopefully it helped you to follow along. But this is just one example that I use in a section of THO 1000. So in THO 1000, we read the Gospel of Mark in full. And there's this lovely story in the second half of the Gospel of Mark, Mark 14, 3 through 9. You may be familiar with it. It's the anointing by the woman at Bethany of Christ. And if you recall in the story, as is the case throughout the Gospel of Mark, the disciples, they tend to half get it right. And they object to the woman anointing Christ because they say, which is not unreasonable, that the fine perfumes and oils, they could have been sold and that money could have been given away to the poor. But what's remarkable is that Christ corrects the disciples and says in very strong language, whenever the gospel is proclaimed, it will be done in memory of her. Right? In other words, there was something emblematic about what she did that in some sense is a summary of the entire gospel. So what did she do? And why might that be the summary of the entire gospel? So this is how shared Christian practice might play itself out in a section of THO 1000 centered around this particular passage. So we begin with a focusing activity. And what I do is I usually show this really short video, which I'm going to show you now. It's called, I Forgot My Phone. So the generative theme for this class is friendship in our digital age. Okay, and the other thing I usually use as a focus activity for this class is this really remarkable exhibit. It's a collection of photographs by Eric Pickersgill. It's called Removed, and what you can see is he scrubbed the images of personal electronic devices. And you can see what's left once you do that. They're almost haunting. So this would be a focusing activity along with that short video. So then movement one, what would that look like? Well, how do personal electronic devices, PED, shape our relationship with others? Specifically, how do PEDs inform our attentiveness, our presence to the other? In friendship. And so in movement two, when we critically examine, after we've named our current praxis, the role of PEDs, particularly in our friendships with one another, we read together as a class a short excerpt by the work of Sherry Turkle called Stop Googling, Let's Talk. And some of you may be familiar with Sherry Turkle's work. She's a professor at MIT. She's known for Alone Together, and her most recent book is called Reclaiming the Conversation in a Digital Age. And what she notes in observing college students at MIT is when they go to the dining halls and they're seated together around the table, she observes what she calls the rule of three. And the rule of three is that at any given point during that conversation at the table, more or less, three students have their heads up. And they're directly caring for and driving the conversation. And everyone else, more or less, is in the screen. And furthermore, what she observed is over the course of the conversation, as someone's head goes down, someone naturally comes up. So throughout the course, more or less, three students are directly caring or directly responsible for that conversation while the others are mostly immersed in their screen. Now, what she noticed is that that radically changes the very nature of conversation, because quite naturally, if you're in a conversation where you're kind of in and kind of out, you check in, you check out, you're engaged directly for part of the time but not the whole time, well, you naturally keep conversations light, because that's the conversation that you can move in and out of. And furthermore, what her study shows is that this leads to an atrophy of the virtue of empathy. And she's noting this in younger and younger children. So going back to the example here, Sherry Turkle's research is a way for students to critically appropriate the praxis they named in movement one when they saw it objectified in front of them. In movement three, then, we read together Mark 14, 3 through 9, in light of Gustavo Gutierrez's interpretation of this passage, which he interprets it as a story about friendship. And so, as is often is the case in the Gospel of Mark, the disciples aren't getting the takeaway message, which is, according to Raymond Brown, we can't understand who Christ is in the Gospel of Mark apart from his identity with the cross. And so we see the woman at Bethany is attentive. She's empathetic to her friend who's on his way to death, right? Because that's what happens after this story. Christ is on his way to the cross after this passage. And his friends, who are rightly concerned about the poor, don't have the same empathy that the woman has, who is anointing Christ as a burial rite. she recognizes that her friend is about to lay down his life for her friends. And her empathy allows her to do that, which requires a type of undivided attention, which is challenged in our day. So movement four, that's that dialectic encounter between the students' critically appropriated praxis and the Christian story of vision. And so a question for movement four might be, how might we better integrate the wisdom of the women at Bethany in our digital age? And then lastly, movement five, that's leading to decision, to action. How might I respond cognitively, behaviorally, affectively to the dialectic encounter? The question might be, what practices might habituate her attentiveness, that's the woman at Bethany, in friendship in our day? So then I'll ask students, yeah, what are we going to do about this? And one of the great suggestions I've got is the students say that when they go out to eat, they put all their cell phones in the middle of the table, and the first person to grab, the bill's on them. Or students talk about going away on a Caritas retreat or a weekend retreat and begrudgingly surrendering their phones, but then realizing how the nature of conversation is transformed because of that. So that would be an example of what this actually looks like with a section of THR 1000. Okay. So my concluding section. That shared Christian praxis originates in the field of religious education raises the inevitable question of its wider applicability to the variegated intellectual life of the modern university. Within the classroom, one can readily imagine the adaptation of a shared Christian praxis approach in other humanity disciplines such as literature, history, philosophy, and even the social sciences, including psychology, sociology, and the field of education itself. The Christian story and vision may be replaced with a source drawn from the relevant discipline that has its own wisdom for life. There may still be a focusing activity around a generative theme that specifically engages learners as agent subjects in the teaching learning event and invites participants to critically appropriate their present praxis toward wisdom for life. Critically appropriated present praxis may be placed in mutually mediating conversation with the relevant source of the discipline. Learners may be invited to make judgments and arrive at cognitive, affective, or behavioral decisions as their learning outcome. Such an adaptation may be more challenging in math and the so-called hard sciences, but even then, the five movements may help educators structure a teaching learning event that incorporates the foundational dynamics of a shared Christian praxis approach. In the book, How College Works, Daniel Chambliss and Christopher Takis conclude that long-standing friendships with fellow students and sometimes teachers are a major result of the college experience. According to their research, friendships play an integral role in learning and are often the central mechanism and daily motivator of student experience. Alumni frequently report that friendships are the most valuable result of their undergraduate years. Chambliss and Takis write, quote, "The pervasive influence of relationships suggests that a college, at least insofar as it offers real benefits, is less a collection of programs than a gathering of people," end quote. Programs matter, to be sure, but friends matter more. Friendship is crucial for students, but having a large number of friends is not. Most students need only two or three good friends and one or two great professors to have a rewarding and even wonderful college experience. The extensive research of Chambliss and Takis conducted at Hamilton College, a small rural and elite liberal arts college in New York, confirms the monumental role of education's interpersonal dimension. Their research can be summed up in a single sentence. Quote, "What really matters in college is who meets whom and when," end quote. College is most effective when it is not primarily about programs or technology, but about meaningful human interaction that can shape student choices, increase motivation, and lead to more overall satisfaction with the college experience. While the idyllic, cloistered context of Hamilton College does not stand in for all of contemporary higher education, Catholic or otherwise, The research suggests that the role of friendship may be at the heart of successful education everywhere. College works when people are committed to learning together. A pedagogy of Caritas initiates, encourages, and sustains the integral of friendship and education. Augustine's classic typology differentiates friendships of pleasure, utility, and virtue. While there is some overlap, friendships grounded in virtue is authentic friendship properly defined. Because it is primarily concerned with wishing the best for the friend, for her own sake, friendship praxis may encourage Catholic educators to resist the instrumental rationality and managerial ethos that dominate higher education today. The overriding concern of education for the marketplace is often fanned by university leaders who tell incoming students that they will be taught to lead full and productive lives, which means they'll be prepared to be good producers and consumers, period. The commodification of higher education, which Catholic universities are certainly not immune to, is part of the global sweep of a homogenizing globalized market. Kevin Hughes proposes the Catholic university as, quote, a school of friendship and wisdom, end quote, that may prophetically engage globalization in both critical and constructive ways. A Catholic university animated by a pedagogy of friendship may more readily resist the lure of prestige envy within a North Atlantic culture of aspirational shoppers whose purchase, let's face it, including higher education, reflects social status anxiety. John Henry Newman tied friendship to the university as he insisted on liberal arts as learning for its own sake rather than as education primarily concerned for utility. Marian Diaz remarks, quote, besides a basic curiosity and desire to know, students and faculty must root their desires in a passion for relationships that grounds themselves in a deep sense of benevolence towards others, end quote. In this light, a pedagogy of friendships may be a source of hope to prophetically resist the overriding tide of education's commodification in our day. Augustine and Aquinas improve on Aristotle's account of friendship in light of revealed truth by making explicit that objective lovableness involves an absolute good. Bernard Lonergan observes that, quote, it is only in a tendency towards an absolute good that one can transcend both egoism and altruism. Such transcendence is implicit in the Aristotelian vision of true friendship, which has its basis not in pleasure, not in advantage, but in the objective lovableness of the virtuous man, end quote. The cooperative missions of the Incarnation and the gift of the Holy Spirit and charity initiate and establish our participation in divine friendship and absolute good. Quote, no longer do I call you servants, for the servant does not know what the master is doing, but I have called you friends. For all that I have heard from my Father, I have made known to you. John 15:15. While in human friendships, authenticity is ever a withdrawal from inauthenticity, by grace, our sharing in divine friendship reverses decline and redeems us. Michael Buckley understands charity as a distinguishing mark of a Catholic university. And I'll conclude with this quote, these words from Michael Buckley. Academic exchange and thought in collaborative inquiry formally constitute the specifying activity of any university. The only spirit that can further specify any community as Christian is charity, that love of friendship for God and for other human beings that bespeaks the influence and teaching of Christ. To the degree that the university's characteristic interchange is permeated by a love of both the truth to be explored and for the human beings who are to come to know it, a love found in the concern that human beings share so great a good as that of sacred and profound knowledge, of reason, of revelation, and that by their influence, especially teaching, they make this same development possible to others, is that university Catholic in spirit. Okay. So we have some time. If anyone has thoughts or questions or want to take this conversation in a different way, I'm all yours. I'd love to learn from your insights. Yeah.
I have a lot of thoughts. Here's one.
Yeah.
Thank you for this. There's a lot to think about here. So you first oriented us by being a friend.
Yeah.
And one that the friend who dies in the four. And one thing that's interesting there is that they haven't really, their relationship is really unhealthy. Mm. He's not loving in God, but also because he sort of made his friend into his little mini disciple.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So he's gotten all hidden with the thoughts of the Manichees, and he comes back to his friend, and he comes back to the small town, and it's like, look, I learned all this stuff in the big city about this awesome new religion, and then he kind of makes him his disciple and draws him away from the true faith.
Yeah.
And so I think part of his grief, part of the reason he's so sad when his friend dies, is that he's grieving the loss of this disciple.
Mm.
So.
Mm. Thank you for that insight.
Sort of friendly suggestion.
I appreciate that.
This
yeah,
is such a
yeah.
Huge temptation to us educators, right?
Yeah.
To think that what needs to happen is we need to like take our amazing ideas and just make our students believe them.
Yeah. Thank you for that insight. You certainly also see that in De Magistro. There is a decentering of the role of the teacher. That the true teacher in Christ is. The true teacher in the classroom is Christ. It's not the teacher that stands before you, which is the teacher within. So there is that. That's what conversion is, right? It's a decentering of the ego, a displacement of the ego. And as teachers, it's important to be mindful that the one whose intellectual, moral, and religious conversion is most at stake is ours in front of the classroom. That we can set the conditions for the possibility of that to occur in our students. It's a gift in them as it is a gift in us. When it comes, we're invited to cooperate or not, but we often don't advert to that going on inside of us. There's a tendency to sit back at the end of the term and to look over the roster and think, all right, who got it and who didn't? Well, what did I get? So thank you very much for that point, that temptation to avoid the educator approaching students as an opportunity to make mini-me's, which is self-referential, not de-centered. Thomas?
Kind of a similar vein. I guess one of the things that is most interesting to me is that I can think of so many teachers I've had who, like, when I reflect on my time with them, friendship never once came into the relationship.
Yeah.
And now for ill, and then in some instances, I do think for good, at least in how they ran their classrooms.
Yeah.
And I guess in terms of this type of pedagogy, like, to what extent is this applicable for professors who have it either through their own kind of dynamic or just how they view their role as teachers, that the goal of friendship, or at least opening a friendship dynamic with students, is kind of at odds with almost a more instructor student power dynamic.
I think that's a fair observation, Thomas. One thing I would make is that when we use the term friendship, it's helpful to ground it in the Aristotelian notion. So what are friendships? According to Aristotle and the Ethics, they're mutual relationships of benevolence motivated by concern for the other's good. And in the ancient world, friendship had a more expansive meaning than it is today, although we're really confused because we can have thousands of friends on Facebook, we know. But it doesn't mean anything. But at the same time, we can also be very, very guarded about friendship in our world too as well. But for Aristotle, mutual relationships of benevolence motivated by concern for the other good. In other words, it doesn't mean that you're meeting up for drinks at the grog every evening or something like that, or hanging out on the weekends. The question is that relationship motivated by benevolence, and is it oriented towards the good together?
So you would say that can exist even in a relationship where, like, there is a clear power shift and difference where, like, the professor's clearly the one running a course.
Yeah, I mean, I think that this does call for a decentered approach to teaching. Mm-hmm. But again, if we return to the Ethics, for Aristotle, Equality isn't sameness. So Aristotle talks about how a parent can have a friendship with a child, and a child can have a parent with a friendship with a parent. And there's a mutual exchange, but it looks different on each side. From the parent to the child, it's paternity. From the child to the parent, it's filiation. But there's still an exchange going on, but the exchange is not exactly the same. There's equality because of the quality of the exchange that is occurring. It is mutual and reciprocal, even though it's not sameness. So I think the same thing you could talk about in terms of the classroom, too, as well. Yeah, Paul?
I really enjoyed this, and one of the gifts of your talk here that came out was the way in which friendship becomes a school or an occasion for attention and empathy, right? And and it strikes me that the same is true of the family as a school of empathy, right? And along the lines of the remarks that Erica made, just again a friendly suggestion.
Yeah, please keep coming.
To be honest, we might think about Monica and the Deo Doctus also as paradigms for Augustine of the named kind of friendship relations along the lines that you were just talking about, where what happens in their exchanges of conversation is one of mutual learning through the kind of devotion to a common good. So I'm thinking about Monica and his conversation at Austin, but also this just came up yesterday in a talk that Erica had given, actually, about the De Magistra, where one of the things that happens in this, it's a conversation between a father and a son, ostensibly about what's happening and why it is that we talk to one another. But there's wordplay, there's this whole exchange, there's this dialogue, and then somewhere along the way, Augustine says, strikingly, you know, what we're doing right now is training for and practice of the beatific vision. It's just kind of startling moment, right? And it doesn't make very much sense if it's only about the topic at hand, how things signify.
Yeah.
Right? If it's about the way in which a mutual concern for one another in this kind of school of attention is focused on the absolute good, then suddenly what they're doing together is something very much like what you're talking about here. It's a kind of Catholic and Christian practice in love. It's less clear to me.
Thank you for that.
It's less clear we work as a university as a whole for our students to do this. It seems like an individual relationship of teacher to student, and especially in the humanities, or where we're privileged to have very discussion-based kind of conversations, this can happen. But I just was wondering if you had any thoughts about how, on the university-wide level, we can be about this work.
Yeah, so a teaching and learning event, we know this doesn't occur within the classroom, right? It occurs all over the place. It's a coach with his players, a coach with her players. It's the liturgy. It's service and immersion. It's our conversations with one another. It's our department meetings. These are all teaching and learning events. So it seems to me in some way we can use this approach. I will say, the thing that I'm not sure about is the so-called hard sciences, but I will say, when I presented a version of this paper at the Lonergan Conference this past summer, Pat Byrne thought, oh yeah, of course you can apply this to the sciences. So I'll take his word for it. But because that's not my academic field or discipline, I think it is more challenging in certain contexts than in others. But if you just take the approach at the most basic level, beginning in a person's critically appropriated life, in conversation, a dialogue, a dialectical encounter with faith, and then it returns to life with that decision, discernment, and then a decision, a response in the world, in service of the world. And it seems to me, broadly, that can be applied to many aspects, many facets of university life. And I think that when we think, reflect upon our best teachers, and however we want to define, however formal we want to understand that term, they intuitively kind of get this, right? In some way, this is just naming what we already know works really well in a theological way, objectifying it so we can appropriate it more fully and more critically in everything we do as a Catholic and Christian university. Yeah, Father Fitzgerald.
Uh-huh. And now there needs to be a reflection. And it seems to me that there's a perfect moment there because a critical reflection on what happened can't be just from the professor.
That's right.
And it really is only successful as far as it becomes a conversation among the students.
Yeah.
And not, just back and forth, front of the room to the back of the room. It somehow embraces.
That's right. Thank you for that. I think that's true. It's Groom calls this a shared Christian praxis approach, so shared is really important. And the shared part is throughout all the different movements, all five of them, certainly through and through. But your point is really, really important. They're inviting students to respond to an exigency which is within them. This is getting back to De Magistro, right? And not the teacher kind of imposing. And I think one of the signs as a teacher I see where this is really working, on one hand, sometimes you'll be in a classroom where the professor refuses to reveal their cards out of a concern for objectivity. I think that's unfortunate because I think that can lead to a miseducation because the students are learning then not to make judgments themselves. They learn not to discern. On the other hand, we've all been in that situation too, where people feel like they got to hold back. They can't really express themselves. They can't speak frankly, which is a sign of friendship because they're worried that the professor's going to bowl them over, or they're going to get penalized for that, or they'll look at them different as a student. And that, to me, also indicates a failure of that classroom to welcome authentic friendship. So I think you're right. I think the exigency should come from within. And it's a shared conversation, the students with one another and the students with the educator as well. Yeah, Barbara.
Thank you. This was great. Two points I would make. One is that you talk about, as Alan mentioned, that section where trying to enter into responding to a relationship.
Yeah.
But what's missing frequently in an age where we rely on social media so much, as you pointed out with that film, it's not only a distraction, it's also an absorption, certainly, but it also is extremely seductive.
It is.
And it takes away from our ability to listen. And that listening requires discipline as well to stop the distractions.
Yeah.
Really pay attention to let go of all these preoccupations, to really hear what someone is saying.
Mm-hmm.
That listening is one of the most difficult skills, I think, today to harness.
Mm-hmm.
The second thing I would mention is, I don't know if you've read anything of Gabriel Marcel, Mystery of Being, one, two. Anyway, it's very reminiscent of the vision at Ostia.
Mm-hmm.
And what he points out, of course, on the whole context love, primary reflection, secondary reflection, et cetera.
Mm-hmm.
But what he's saying is that when two people are able to love each other on that level of friendship, of recognizing the good in the other, that at that moment of openness, because love too is an openness.
That's
of
right.
Someone to another. So is listening an openness. That it's there, that enter into that kind of relationship that then mm-hmm. exposes you mm-hmm. to something more than yourself.
Mm-hmm.
Not just in the mm-hmm. other, but also in the mm-hmm. God, which is kind of
yeah,
charming.
It's extraordinary. Thank you for those astute observations, Barbara. So the role of receptivity, mm-hmm. right? Of listening, which is the work of the Holy Spirit. Right? Is that wonderful line from E.M. Forrester, poor talkative Christians, that we're constantly talking. I think that's crucial. I think that's important. And Turkle talks about that, and that how the phone becomes a dopamine. We become addicted to it. And then it becomes an obstacle to the intellectual life, because what it does is it rules out boredom. Because once you have the hint of boredom, for example, that often happens in small talk when you talk to your classmate right next to you rather than you're engaged in the screen. As soon as you notice boredom, well, then you have this escape. You have this promise of entertaining and informative stimuli, just waiting. But we know in the intellectual life, boredom is important. Because oftentimes you got to work through that in order for that insight to come. And it's tedious. And it's not entertaining. But we also know that that attentiveness, that focus, even when it's not emotively pleasurable, is crucial to the intellectual life, as it is with our friendships with one another. So thank you, Barbara, for that.
Well,